song? How many of you know that you can buy that song in iTunes or Spotify? All right. If you already bought that song, you know you can tell your friends and promote that song. Amen. Because it's a prophetic song. I remember many years ago, Prophet Chuck Pierce came to our church and he said that a new sound will come out from this house. Isn't that good? A new sound. Can you say a new sound? All right, praise the Lord. Can you give Jesus a big hand one more time? Come on. Woo! Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I have one announcement correction about the graduation celebration. There is a change because many are not available for Friday celebration. And because of that, those who have registered, the celebration will be within your respective carousel. So I apologize that we are not going to have as a celebration with the whole church. But that is the reason why many are not available for Friday celebration. So those of you, how many graduates we have in the house? Let me see your hand. All right. Oh, wow. Yeah. All right. So congratulations to all of you. So we will celebrate the graduates on Sunday with a recognition on June 26. So that is the announcement correction that I'm going to tell you. Praise the Lord. Are you ready for the word?
Yes.
Okay. Tell your neighbor, ask your neighbor, are you ready for the word? Are you? What's the answer?
Yes.
Well, there were two gentlemen on the flight to from Chicago to Los Angeles. They were sitting next to each other. And one gentleman was a lawyer and the other one was an older man. And the older man, he was kind of tired, he was sleepy. But the lawyer, he was anxious to talk to someone, so he kept on bugging the older man, and he asked this question to the older man. He said, how about if we play a game here? I'm tired, I want to sleep, you know. And then the lawyer said, how about this? Let's make a deal. If I ask you a question and you cannot answer, you give me $5. But if you ask me a question and I cannot answer, I will give you $500. Wow. So the older man reluctantly said yes. So the lawyer began to ask the question to the older man. Okay, let me start first, okay? And I said, what is the distance between the earth to the moon? The older man rolled his eyes and he didn't know the answer, so he just gave the lawyer $5. And then the older man asked the lawyer, okay, what animal is it when he goes up to the hill, it has 3 legs, and going down the hill, it has 4 legs? Wow. The lawyer was, he didn't know the answer. So how many of you know that in the newer flight, you can have a Wi-Fi? So he Googled, animal that goes up the hill with 3 legs, going down the hill with 4 legs. And he emailed some of his friends and no reply. So, he was upset. So he reached out to his pocket and then gave the older man $500 because he didn't know the answer. And then he leaned back, but he was frustrated. $500, oh my goodness. He waited for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, he was upset. And then he asked that older man, tell me, what is that animal? The older man didn't answer, you know, he just reached out his pocket and gave him $5. Praise God. I want to welcome Pastor Hermanto and the family from Sacramento City Blessing. Just arrived. And Gabby just graduated from UCLA. Congratulations. Proud of you. Woo! Praise God. How many of you were here last week? Let me see your hand. How many of you still remember what I preached last week? And it's about the paralytic, I pronounce it right this time, all right, and with palsy, and how many of you know that some of you are stuck, some of you, you really want to move forward, but somehow you are stuck, and you are stuck in your life, you're stuck in your faith, you're stuck in your anger, you're stuck in financially, you're stuck in many different ways, but you know, I want to continue what I preached last week, and I want you to open to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 2, and I pray that God is going to unstuck you. Amen? Yes. And how many of you will pray with me that you can pray, Lord, help me, I'm stuck. Lord, help me, I'm stuck. I don't want to be stuck anymore. And I do believe that God is going to set you free today. Amen. God is going to set you free today. Amen. Some of you may have a tremendous year last year, but some of you may have a trying year last year. But I have a good news for you that you don't have to be stuck anymore because God has a great plan for you. And I have the word that I know God is going to speak individually, personalized, customized word for each one of us. You say amen?
Amen.
If you get Deuteronomy chapter 2, I want you to read with me. I'm reading from the New King James Translation. It says, "And the Lord spoke to me, saying, you have skirted this mountain long enough, semicolon, turn northward. You have skirted this mountain long enough, turn northward." In the Message Translation, the same chapter and verse, it says, "Then God said, you have been going around in circles in this hill long enough. Go north. You have been going in circle long enough. You have been going around in circle in this hill, in this mountain, long enough." Long enough. That's the word. That's the word stuck means you're going over and over and over again. You're going over and over again. You're going in a circle. And God said, enough. Enough is enough. Enough is enough. But do you know that some of us, we do not realize that we are stuck? So let's begin with that. Let's begin with allowing the Word of God to speak to us, because when we study the Bible, when we do Bible study, I learned that many times without realizing it, we do not allow the Bible to study us. So let's allow the Bible to study us. Could it be possible that you are stuck and you don't know it? And I remember many years ago, I think 4 or 5 years ago, I got a chance to meet this man. He's a bishop from Ohio, and he shared his childhood experience when he grew up with his two other brothers. In the olden days, how many of you in the olden days, you know that television doesn't have remote control, and you have to, if you want to change the channel, you have to click that round thing, you know, click, 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 click. How many of you live in that olden days? Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. Well, let me tell you, in the olden days, we don't have remote control, okay? So he told a story, his experience, that many times that he wants to watch one particular channel when his brother wants to watch the other channel. So they, you know, keep on clicking that round thing, you know, click, 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 you know, and they broke it. They broke it. And you know what? They finally settled to change the channel. They use plier. They use plier, and it's more difficult, but yes, they can change the channel with the plier. 1 week, 2 weeks, 2 months, 3 months, and they get used to it. It becomes their new normal. Until one day, their parents' friend visit the house, And when he looked at the television, he said, hey, what is that plier stuck on TV? You know, it's not normal. So they just realized, they were aware that actually it was not normal for a plier to stick on a television. It took somebody from the outside to reveal something that they thought was their new normal, but it is not normal. Are you with me? So could it be possible that you are stuck and you don't know it? Could it be possible that you're stuck and you think it's normal because you have been living in that situation for 1 year or 2 years or 10 years or even for generations and you think it's normal? So how many of you now, you want to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you and said, Lord, whatever you have for me, speak to me. How many of you are willing to do that? How many of you want to go forward? How many of you really want to allow the Holy Spirit to bring you to the next level in your life? Let me see your hand. Come on. And if you really mean what you say, you know, God is going to lead you. God is going to open the windows of heaven and he's going to bring you into a breakthrough. You don't have to stuck. You don't have to be stuck anymore. And in this context, God suddenly spoke to them. God said, you have gone through this long enough. Can we personalize that verse? Do you believe that the Word of God is alive?
Yes.
Can you believe that He is talking to you right now? You've argued about certain things long enough. You've gotten in debt long enough. You lost your way long enough. And if you are still living in the same life you were living 5 years ago, could it be possible that you are circling the same mountain over and over and over again? You're going through the same issues. You're going through the same circumstances. You're living from paycheck to paycheck. You're struggling verbally, physically, sexually, financially. You have to decide, are you happy to go around the same mountain? You have to decide today. Make a decision today. And I said several times that many times, many people just like to sing, but they don't like to hear the word of God because when you sing, you don't need to make a decision, so to say, you know. But when you hear the message, at the end of the message or during the message, as the message is being preached, you're asked to make a decision because whatever decision that you are going to take will change your life. Or even if you don't make a decision, that decision becomes your decision. You go to work, you go home, you go to church. You go to work, you go home, you go to carousel. You go to school, you go home, you go to church. You receive Jesus, yes, you're baptized, all right. But you know somehow that you are not free. How can that be? You're going through that same situation over and over and over again, and somehow deep in your heart, you know something is not, but Pastor, I'm saved, right? I received Jesus, right? Yes, okay, I opened my heart and I confessed Jesus is my Lord. Yes, I did, but I know somehow deep inside of me, in my inner man, I know, oh, Pastor, I don't want this. I'm tired. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired in my life. But what happened with me here? Why you are not free? Your sins are forgiven. For sure you know that. But you've been sinned against. People hurt you, people disappointed you, some people abuse you maybe, cheated on you, so you're wounded. And you begin to think intellectually, well, I know intellectually that I'm supposed to be free, but experientially, how come I'm not free? Many of us were wounded because we were sinned against. With that comes anger. With that comes a feeling of helplessness. You're confused about your future. You're enraged. You have domestic violence inside of you. Abuse, hostility, dysfunction, fear, and negative attitude. And you wonder, how could I be saved and have all of those? Now, before I continue again, the Holy Spirit is here. Let us not just read the Bible, but allow the Bible to read us so that you will have an encounter with God even at the reading of His Word and at the preaching of His Word. The Hebrew, they were enslaved by the Egyptian. If Moses just told the people to apply the blood, but not out of Egypt, and cross the Red Sea through liberation, they would have been saved, but still live under the oppression of Pharaoh, who sinned against them. They were in bondage for many years. And they thought it was normal. Until one day God spoke to Moses. Well, I want to set my people free. And every man in the household, they have to get a lamb and kill the perfect lamb. You know, not there is no, what do you call that? No blemish. Perfect lamb. And then you put the blood on the doorpost. Because if you don't do that, every firstborn man, every firstborn family or animal, they will be killed. What if they did that and when the angel of death passed their houses, when the angel of death passed the Egyptians' house, of course they have no blood, and the angel of death killed every firstborn in the household. But when the angel of death passed by the Hebrew people and the angel of death saw the blood, there was no death in the house. But what if they were saved, but they still live in Egypt? Something familiar can be fatal because you see yourself, what you went through, rather than understanding you can go through it and not be it. There are three groups of people. The first group of people is the oppressor. They will oppress you. The oppressor oppressed. The oppressor. That's the characteristic of the oppressor, the oppressed. And the second group of people is the victim. And usually we only recognize those two groups of people, not realizing that there is the third group of people, which is a victimized predator. This kind of people, they hate what they do, but they can't stop it. Why? Because they were victim, and because they were victim, they channel it to others. They channel it to their spouse when they get married. They channel it to their husband, their wives, their children, their friends at work, friends at school. Why? Because this kind of people are the kind of people that say, I'm sorry, I don't know why I keep on doing this. I'm sorry, I don't know why I keep on cheating. I don't know why I keep on frustrating. I don't know why I keep on get mad. I could not handle my anger. How come? I'm sorry. But they keep on living in that. Why? Because they are stuck. That's the third group of people. So I don't know who you are. But again, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us right now, because let Him bring the awareness just in case. You are stuck. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. I'm going to read from two translations. The first one is from the New King James Translation, then I'm going to read from the Message Translation. So let me read to you from the New King James Translation, which says, Romans 12, verse 2, if you got it, say amen. All right. Hallelujah. The Word of God is so powerful. I said it over and over again. One word from God can change your life. Just one word from God can change your life. It says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. In the Message translation, it says, don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Woo. Readily recognize what He wants from you and quickly respond to it, unlike the culture around you. Always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you. God brings the best out of you. And sometimes you don't know it. God will bring the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. You know you are saved, yeah. When you receive Jesus into your life, your spirit is recreated. But you're dealing with issues that were once in your mind before. And now, what makes it worse, because now you go to church, now you're saved, you got to act like you're okay. You got to pretend everything is all right. You put on a smile, professional smile. How are you doing? I'm fine, Pastor. How are you doing? Hallelujah. Is everything good? Yeah, everything is good. Oh, yeah. What makes it worse is we don't realize that we just because we are safe, but inside of you, there is a cry. If I can say a silent cry, and that silent cry sometimes is deafening. That silent cry is crying in within you that says, oh, how come I still have this? I'm frustrated. I'm tired of getting sick and tired. But when you go to church, when you get into the environment, so good environment, you become good. You cover up, you put on mask, and you got to pretend because the pressure is on you to be presentable, acceptable by the Christian clique. Instead of looking for an answer, you put on a mask. Instead of seeking a way to be set free and renewed. I like the English language, you know, re, that's a prefix. That word re means again, renew. So the word is not to change your mind. No, don't change your mind. Renew your mind. That means actually before the sin, before the fall, man has perfect mind. Mind is powerful. Your mind is so powerful. Your brain is so powerful. Your brain is so powerful. And what I'm telling you right now is not about positive thinking. What I'm telling you right now is the brain that is renewed by the power of the Holy Spirit. That is so powerful. And your brain alone is so powerful. I remember on the way from Los Angeles to Taipei a couple of weeks ago, I watched this movie. It's a true story. The African-American runner by the name of Jesse Owens, and he broke the world record, and no one broke the record for 25 years. And his coach said to him, you know, Jesse, you run just because you have fast legs doesn't make you a winner. You run not only with your legs, you run with your brain. And if you really want to excel, do you know that 0.1 second make a big difference? Do you know that 0.1 second will determine whether you will have gold medal or silver? Do you know that 0.1 second may have a $5 million deal? Now, when we put it to money, then you know what I'm talking about. So your brain, when it's renewed by the power of the Holy Spirit, it's so powerful. That's why the Bible said, Paul said, we have the mind of Christ. Your brain alone is powerful. Use it. But not only that, when you allow the Holy Spirit to fill your brain, you have the mind of Christ. Powerful. Now, if you recognize that you are stuck, and if the Holy Spirit begins to speak to you right now, certain areas in your life, whatever it is, and you know, oh yeah, yeah, okay, oh yeah, now I know why. Now, what to do? Well, let me tell you a story about this man. He had an infirmity, and I don't have to open the chapter and verse, but let me just, for the sake of time, if you remember the story in John chapter 5, there was a man with infirmities, and in that place, you know, in the pool, there was a pool, and people that were lame, blind, sick, and they were there, and they were waiting for the angel to move, to shake the water, and whoever jumped to the pool first, you know, they got healed. And this man with infirmities, he didn't get healed, and Jesus came to him and said, hey, do you want to be made whole? Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be healed? Now, if you recognize, as I'm speaking, do you begin to recognize that you are stuck? The Holy Spirit is asking you this question now. Do you want to be unstuck? Do you want to be set free? Do you want to be liberated? And I learned that God honored your decision. If I were there and Jesus asked that question to this man, I would have thought, don't just ask the question, just hear him. He's been there for 38 years. 38 years, how many of you know that 38 years is a long time? 38 years. Why did Jesus, with all due respect, why did Jesus ask him that question? Because God honors your decision. You must have the will. You must have the want. You must say, yes, I want to be healed. Yes, I want to be set free. Yes, I want to be whole again. And you know why? Apparently, I observed that some people that are stuck, they want to stay stuck. Even some people who are sick, they like to be sick. Why? Because they can use it as an excuse. Because they can use it so that people will have pity on him or her. Because of the infirmities, people will donate money to him or her. And they don't have to work. And because of that, people just say, oh, I'm fine here. I'm fine. Everything is okay. But God has a big plan for you, even bigger than you have ever thought or imagined. God has such a big plan for you. The question is, do you want to make the right decision today and allow God to set you free? I remember many years ago, there was a conference, and there were about 2,500 people in that church building, and a prophet, a mighty prophet, prophesied. In the middle of this crowd, you know, he prophesied that, he said, oh, the Holy Spirit revealed to me that there is a man in this place. He got into accident last year, and God is going to heal you right now. And you got into a car accident, and you have problem with your spine. God is going to heal you right now. And this man stopped. He paused. And nobody responded. You can hear a pin drop. And then the prophet continued. The Lord revealed to me that the accident happened in August of last year. And the Lord showed me that you went to see this doctor, and the name of the doctor is, and he mentioned the name of the doctor, believe it or not. And so who is that person? He waited, and nobody said anything, nobody confessed, nobody admitted. If you were there, what would you think? You may have thought that this prophet, it made a mistake. Crazy prophet, why don't you just move on? But he waited. And then a few long minutes later, somebody stood up, went up to the front, and said, sir, you describe every detail about me. And you know what happened, sir? The moment you said that, my spine got instantly healed. But excuse me, sir, can you heal me next week? Because my insurance settlement comes within 2 days. And they are going to do the final check. So that means some people, they want to stay stuck. Oh, Jesus. How about you? I pray that you will allow the Holy Spirit in whatever circumstance. Maybe your faith stuck. Whatever it is. You're good now, but you're stuck in your goodness. The good things hinder you to experience the best from God. Some people make an excuse. Somebody said there was a twin was raised by an alcoholic father. One of them grew up and became an alcoholic. Someone asked him, why you become an alcoholic? He replied, because my father was an alcoholic. The other twin never touched a drink in his life. They asked him, "Why are you not an alcoholic?" He replied, "Because I was raised by an alcoholic." So the decision is in you. You cannot blame others. You make the decision. I dare you to make the right decision. Because if I ask you how many of you want to move forward, that is a rhetoric question. Everybody wants to go forward. And I'm almost certain that 100% of you will say yes. But sometimes your outward confession is not the same with your inward conviction. This message is not for everybody. This message is only for those who want to cross over. Some people are stuck and they don't know it. Some of you are making more money than you have ever had, but you are more miserable than you have ever been. So money can also make you stuck. Are you still breathing? In the last several messages, I've been asking that question because I felt like, you got so tense. Oh, yeah, okay. Don't move, you know. Don't move. Renew your mind. Renew your mind. Let's just relax for a little bit, okay? I remember when I grew up, I'm the youngest in the family, and my brother, he is 7 years older than me, and he is taller, bigger, more muscular than me, and, you know, he, from time to time, he tickled me, and, I don't like that, and, but, you know, he tickled me, and, I don't like it, but, you know, so he laughed, and I laughed, and I was out of breath, you know, I laughed, but I didn't like it. And he kept on doing it. And I couldn't do nothing to change him. He's bigger, he's taller, more muscular. Oh. But I did something. I changed my mind. I made a decision that I'm not going to be ticklish. Wow. Wow. I command my brain. It's not funny. But you laugh, right? It's not funny. Well, I was the victim. I'm not going to be ticklish anymore. So I said, you know, and the next time, sure enough, when he tickled me, you know, I just... He did what he used to do, but I did not respond the way I used to respond. And from that day to this day now, I'm not ticklish. I don't know whether it's good or bad. That illustration could be, maybe the enemy is trying to attack you for a number of months or years, that it becomes your habit. And that habit, because it is recognized and received by your friends, it becomes a culture. And you say, everybody is doing it. And it becomes your new normal, but actually it is not normal. If you allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you, it could be pornography, it could be lust, it could be sexual perversion, it could be anger, it could be whatever. When the enemy comes to attack you, when the enemy do what he used to do, you are not going to respond the way you used to respond. Now, can you take a deep breath now? I remember at that time, my brother was, he was determined to tickle me. At several points, you know, several times he would catch a dragonfly alive. And he would put it, you know, he would put his leg on both of my legs and his arms, you know, and then he pulled my shirt, you know, and then put the dragonfly to my belly button, you know. Can you see it? Can you see it? That legs, the dragonfly, you know. And then the dragonfly would flap the wings. But I just hold my breath. Because I use mind over matter. Can you see that God has prepared these thoughts, the renewed thoughts in our mind that we can cross over? We don't have to go over the circle and the mountain over and over again, over and over again. And the people, in this context, they have been circling the same mountain for 40 years. In another context, in the book of Daniel, they've been in the captivity for 400 plus years. Can you relate to me? If you were in that situation for 40 years or 400 years, could it be possible that it ingrains in our minds that it's normal? You don't know what free means. You don't know what liberation means. You don't know that. That's why God, the Word of God is so powerful. The Word of God will show you who you are. The Word of God will show you. God will bring forth the greatness out of you. And you don't know it. God will keep on affirming you that you are awesome. You are loved. You are special. You are powerful. You are anointed. I'm going to give you one question that you need to ask yourself. When has the past had enough of your attention? When was the last time you gave your past your attention? For years, I thought that my past was holding me. I became the victim. And so forth and so on, my failure. For years, I thought that my past was holding me. I didn't realize that I was holding it. Your past cannot control you. You can control your past. Let it go. And you hold it. But Pastor, I didn't hold it. I want to be set free. I want to be liberated. That's not right, Pastor. I don't hold it. Well, you hold it with your mouth. You hold it with your thoughts. You hold it by you won't let yourself get over it. You keep on entertaining your past in your mind. Ask yourself this question. Again, this is a simple question. When was last time you gave your past your attention? Otherwise, you may go in life in circle, and it may be fun, but you're still in circle. Have you ever seen a rat race in the, what do you call that, in the cage, in a circle? What do you call that? Hamster wheel. And the rat or the hamster could be so excited. In the same place. Have you ever seen, how many of you have dogs? Your dog play with his own tail? Have you seen that? Chasing his own tail? It's fun. You thought it's fun, but you're going nowhere. In life? Well, you think you're doing good. I don't blame you. It's not always that you are in the bad situation. What I'm saying is, would you allow God to speak to you? God, I know that this is not it. So show me. I want to change. The Word of God says, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. Oh, God. I don't want to look free. I don't want to act like as if I am free. I don't want to pretend I am free. I want to be free in my mind. I want to be free in my heart. I want to be free in my spirit. I want to be free in my life. Renewed mind, renewed life. Oh, Jesus. I remember many years ago, my father taught me how to drive. And he's here back in the U.S. with me. He's only 91 years young right now. And I remember at that time, you know, one day when I was still 13, 14 years old, it was illegal, by the way. Don't tell anyone. So my father taught me how to drive. And well, in Indonesia, you know, well, all my life living in Indonesia, I drove with no driver license. Shh, don't tell anyone, it's a secret. My dad taught me how to drive, and he said something like this: the car will always go in the direction you look. Well, of course, the car will go to a direction if you set aside, you pick up your phone, you text and drive. The car will go its own way, but what you are paying attention to, your body will follow. Your attention will affect your driving direction. If you want to know which direction you are going, monitor what you are saying. Why? Do you want to know why? Ask me that question, then I'll answer you. Okay. Because your mouth is telling what your heart is seeing. Some people, when they talk, they don't listen to what other people talk. While some people, they talk, they even don't know what they are talking about. My encouragement to all of us, why don't we monitor what we say? Meaning, when you follow carefully what you say, then you know what is in your heart. And then you can answer that question, whether you are holding back the best that God has in store for you, or are you going to repent? Can you say repent? Repent, repent, repent. You know, the word repent means you renew your mind. Repent means you if you walk towards this direction and then you repent and then you turn around, going the other direction. You repent, metanoia, you change the way you think, you change, you renew. Not a new mind, but you're being renewed. It's like it was like as if before man fell into sin. God wants to renew our mind like that. Powerful. I am not claiming that I have that. I'm not claiming that I've achieved that. I'm still in progress, WIP, work in progress. But I know that I'm better than I was 10 years ago. I know that I am better than I was 5 years ago. But have I achieved everything? No, not yet. Not yet. There are still imperfections in my way of thinking. And what I learned also is this. When you get saved and you come to Jesus, your mind is still being renewed. And you allow the Holy Spirit to guide you. There are still some possibilities that in your journey of life, you will go back to a similar situation again. And when that happens, how many of you know what I'm talking about? Hello. You pray, you go to the altar, you make a commitment that you are not going to be angry anymore, you are not going to be enraged anymore. Okay, you made a decision. And then somewhere along the line, you blew up. And this is what usually happens. You know why? I can share this to you because I experienced it. When that happens, the enemy will immediately whisper to my ear and said, you have not changed. Let me tell you, that's not true. Yes, you can still sin. Yes, you can still mess up. Yes, you can still fail. But because I dare you to make a decision, and if you do, that decision becomes your new normal. And if you mess up again, you will not have the pleasure in it anymore. Could it be pornography? Could it be sexual sin? If you are going through that situation, you say to the devil, I refuse that. I am a changed man. I am a changed woman. You say that. I refuse to stay the same. This is my new normal. I am destined to live like this. I recognize right now. And the devil cannot pull you down. You are free. Woo! Hallelujah. Amen. And you can say with confidence, I am a new person. I am a new man. I am a new woman. Hebrews chapter 12. Let's read from verse 14 to 17. Hebrews 12:14. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. 15. Looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled. 16. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person like who? Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For you know that afterwards, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for what? No place for what? Oh, what did I say about repentance? Repentance means change your way of thinking. He was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought it diligently with tears. Esau might have a great destiny, might have a great plan. I could just imagine it could have been. In the Bible, it could have been. It's just my, you know, when I read the Bible, he is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Esau. But no. Why? Because Esau did not allow his mind to be renewed. Could it be that what caused you to stuck is in between our own ears? You are powerful. Tell your neighbors you are powerful. Sometimes we say that we don't really know what it means, but you are very powerful, man. And we are in the company of powerful people because of Jesus. Esau compromised for a bowl of soup. And I realized that, again, let's just allow the Holy Spirit to help us to make the right decision, that it's not enough just going to church. It's not enough just stay in a rut, going circle in the mountain over and over. It's not enough, you know. It's not enough just going to church, going to carousel. This is not it. God has a great plan. Do you understand that going to church doesn't make you a believer, a follower of Jesus Christ? Do you realize that the devil doesn't even care if you go to church? The devil is not afraid if you come to church and you jump. The devil is not afraid when you lift up your hand. It means nothing. The devil is not afraid of me just because I preach. But the devil is afraid when you have a renewed mind. Do you understand that Judas was in every worship service with Jesus for over 3 years? The other disciples, they have their own share of weaknesses. They complain. They doubt. But they are not like Judas. Judas refused to repent. He saw all the miracles. He was there. So how many of you begin to, at least you have that assurance now, and you begin to at least say with confidence. Yes, Lord, renew my mind, please. How many of you begin to allow the Holy Spirit to do that in your life? I would. Esau cried. He cried. He gave his birthright. He lost his birthright. He lost his future. He lost his destiny. And Esau made a permanent decision over a temporary situation. Giving away the next 30 years for the next 30 minutes. Can you say repentance? Repentance. Say it loudly. Louder. An emotional response is not equal to change. Some people cry and lie at the same time. It rhymes, cry, lie. I saw people, they come to the altar, they cry, snorted. But actually, there is no conviction inside. If you allow the Holy Spirit to change your, to renew your mind, then your life is renewed. You will always have a new normal, which is according to the Word of God, if you allow the Word of God to dominate your life. It will automatically, it will go back. It's just like the default system. I just texted Dion a couple of days ago because in my house, we have two wireless network. One is weak and one is stronger. And for whatever reason, 99% every time I turn on my computer, the one that has the weaker wireless network always pops up. So I asked him, how can I change the default? And then he sent me a link in the YouTube that I can change the default. If you allow your way of thinking to the right default in the Word of God, whatever it is, just allow Him. Because the story in the prodigal son, Luke chapter 15, was that? I forgot, maybe 9? How many of you remember that story, the prodigal son? The default for the pigs are the mud. But the son, at one point he realized, I am here, but I'm not supposed to be here. I am here, but I don't belong here. I made a decision right now. I'm going to go back to my father's house. You allow the default system right here. Allow the Word of God to change you. You know, you can change your hair, you can change your clothes, you can change your hairstyle, you can change your address, you can change your phone number, you can change your nail polish, you can change your friend, but if you don't change your mind, you will stuck. How many of you, when the Holy Spirit begin to show you and you recognize where you are stuck, and you begin to say right now in your heart, in your spirit, you say, I'm tired of being sick and tired, I'm tired. That's it, enough is enough. I've been here long enough. Could be 40 years, could be 400 years, could be 10 years. Jesus. Lord, I thank you. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that you have prepared your word. Before we even have that problem, you have provided the solution. Now, in the next few minutes, hang on with me for a few minutes, okay? This is a very important moment in our life here, in our time. This is another moment. This is another milestone. Another milestone that we can make. This is a life changer. This is a game changer. And you want to make, you know, a decision right now. And you want to change your default setting and develop a new normal. And you allow the Holy Spirit to change your and develop a new normal. And you attack the old pattern. You break old habits. And you demand the change. And you allow the Holy Spirit to work. You know, as we have every head bowed right now, let me tell you that, this kind of conviction is so powerful. And this type of change is only achievable when there is the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And He will give you the power to be able to change. You don't need to be frustrated anymore. Because God is saying to us right now, you have been circling this mountain long enough. Go up north. There is more in you than you have seen. You are more than this mountain you stuck around. Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now, the next few moments, as you focus, you know, sometimes sometimes when you close your eyes, you can see better. You know what I mean? So don't let anything distract you. Usually I would ask a question and you would come and respond and come forward to the altar. And I got this, you know, this word, the altar. When you bring your sacrifice, you come to the altar and you bring your sacrifice. When you bring your gift, your tithe, your offering, you bring it to the altar and you bring your tithes and you give your offerings. But when you come to the altar, what I'm focusing right now is not for you to bring an offering. Can you see yourself that when you come to the altar, you don't bring sacrifice, but you climb up to the altar and you are the sacrifice. Not your money, not your giving, but you. That's why the Bible said, make your body as a living sacrifice. So can you picture yourself not to give a sacrifice? No. You put your name there. You go up to the altar and say, here I am, God. I am on the altar now. Use me so that I know what is good, acceptable, and perfect will of God, my Father. With that, I'm going to ask you, and this question needs a response on your side for you to make a decision. I'm not going to ask you to come forward, but if you want to make a decision, which I said earlier, I dare you to make a decision today, and you will not regret it. If you say, God, here I am, renew my mind. Renew my mind. I don't want to be stuck anymore. And if you want to make that decision without emotion, because sometimes people make decisions without even crying, and that is so, it is life-changing. So you don't have to cry. Just make a decision. It's not wrong to cry, but what we learn from Esau, he sought it with tears, but he didn't get it because he only focused on the emotional. So if you right now, just begin to allow the Holy Spirit again to speak to you, and you will respond to Him, not to me. It doesn't make any difference whether I see you or not, but it makes a difference when you make a decision, and as an act of faith, you say to God, and you lift up your hand and said, I want to renew my mind. If you are the person, that person, lift up both of your hands right now. Meaning you surrender both of your hands. Both of your hands, yes. You surrender, you surrender, you surrender, you surrender, you surrender, yes, you surrender. Oh, you surrender. Yes, 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 yes. Yes, yes, yes. Oh God, oh God, oh God. This is the presence of God is here. The presence of God is here. Yes, this is a beautiful moment. This is a holy moment. This is so precious because you can touch heaven right now by your response. And this is a good thing. And you make a declaration right now. You can say it softly. You can shout it if you want, but you say, I refuse to stay the same. I refuse to move in circle. I refuse to hold my past. I'm not going to hold it anymore. I'm going to move forward. I'm going to move forward. I realize now that my past cannot hold me. I realize now that I was the one that held my past. And now you allow God. Yes, no more. You get rid of that anger. You get rid of that pornography. You get rid of that sexual perversion. You make a decision. I'm tired of being sick and tired. I know that God has a great plan for me. I'm tired of being a victim. I'm tired of even becoming victimized predator. No, I don't want to be a victimized predator. Oh, I want to put it to a stop right now. I don't want my children to be the victim. I don't want my family to be the victim because of what I experienced in the past. I don't want my friends to be the victim. You make a decision right now. Yes, you cry out to Him. Cry out to Him. That silent cry that is deafening has been there in your heart for quite some time, and God is setting you free right now. Oh, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God. Thank you, Jesus. You look at these people, they lift up both of their hands in surrender. You know what that means? It's not by your might, it's not by your power, but by the Holy Spirit. So from now on, you have your new normal, which is according to the Word of God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. When you go home, you will face challenges. And when the enemy begin to whisper in your ear, you have not changed. No, you have made a decision right now. You made that decision in front of God, in the presence of God. You are a changed person. You are not going to be the same anymore. Woo. Hallelujah. Open your eyes now. How many of you thank God? He is awesome. How many of you can really say, oh God, I thank you for your word? How many of you can praise Jesus? How many of you can, oh, you know that you are being liberated, you know, because of the truth of the word of God. You are no longer the same. Oh God. Let's all stand up. I know it's rather long, but it's worth spending the time. And I want to encourage you to even, you know, carousel leaders, you can discuss this in the carousel, in your carousel. Discuss it. You listen to the sermon again. It's in our archive. It's uploaded by tomorrow, and you can check it out and listen to it again, and you can have that assurance, and you know who you are, and God wants to draw the best out of you. That's who our God is. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. I think it's good if we have a praise song we can sing. I'm sorry I caught you by surprise. Don't look at me like that. Well, if not, it's okay. Thank you, Jesus. You have something? 1, 2, 3. Okay. I think it's good if we take a few minutes to sing praise. Thank you.
The divide, lost in our sin, you made us alive. How can we ever hold it inside? We can't hold back. So we're gonna lift you higher, higher. Hearts burning bright like a fire, fire. Voices unite, make it louder, louder. We're never gonna stop singing. You made us alive. How can we ever hold it inside? We can't hold that. So we're gonna lift you higher, higher. Hearts burning bright like a fire, fire. Voices unite, make it louder, louder. We're never gonna stop singing. Burning bright light.
bless you. God bless you. Go home and apply the word. Give your neighbor a high five. God bless you. Love you. Man, see you Saturday.